Well, welcome everybody. What a joy it is to be together. Thank you for joining us today. Would you hear these words of Psalm 95? The scripture says, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods." We celebrate the kingship of our Lord, the creator of the universe. We're going to remember and celebrate. Let's sing, "Come, let us worship."
Oh, come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things.
We're going to remember today. See what our Savior.
See what our Savior has done.
Oh,
see how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things.
Oh, hero.
Cause, oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things.
We dance.
We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things.
He's been faithful.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things.
And I know, and I know, and I know, and I know.
And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things.
Oh, hero.
So, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things.
Let's sing hallelujah.
Of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great.
We dance.
We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great.
You've done great things, you've done great things. Let's sing about the things he's done. Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all hands.
Who shakes?
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life that I would be set free. Yeah. Oh, Jesus,
that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations? Who rules the nations? With truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is amazing grace. You've done for me. Oh, for all that you've done for me, we're gonna sing, we're gonna sing. Let's sing about the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world, worthy of our praise. 'Cause worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain for the sin of the world. Worthy, worthy is the King who conquered the worthy. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. So worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is a you've done, for all that you're going to do. It's why we sing, it's why we worship you. So we celebrate, we sing hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. We sing of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance, we dance in your freedom, awakened alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. Well, I pray today, wherever you may find yourself, that you're experiencing the love of God that we've been talking about, that you've been experiencing the peace and the grace of the gospel that is provided to us. And if you're not, I want to remind you today of a promise. Jesus said in John chapter 14, I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. And in a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. Sometimes it can feel like we don't see Jesus, like we don't see God's presence. But his promise to us is that even though we don't see him, yet we can live because of the gift of his Holy Spirit that he has given to us. Later on in John's gospel, Jesus goes on to promise that the Holy Spirit would lead us and guide us into all truth. So if you're feeling lost today, if you're feeling disconnected, I want to encourage you by the word of God and hold fast to the promises that it contains, that we can be connected one to another, that we can be connected to Jesus Christ, the living one, who because he lives, we also may live. So wherever you are, would you make just a sanctuary, a place where you welcome God's Holy Spirit, his presence into the midst of your heart. We're going to sing about it. Would you sing with us?
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living home. In your presence, Lord.
I've tasted
and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
Your presence, Lord,
in your presence, Lord.
We sing, Holy Spirit, you're welcome here.
And Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. 'Cause your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence.
I've tasted and seen
of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone.
Oh, in your presence, Lord,
in your presence, Lord.
Oh, Holy Spirit.
Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
This is our prayer. Lord, help us to become aware.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
We sing, Holy Spirit.
And Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. 'Cause your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Jesus bled and Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone.
So we sing together, oh, praise the name of the Lord our God.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord our God.
Then on the third,
and break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is Your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord. That's the gospel story. What God has done, we believe it. We stand in the light of that truth. But the fullest picture of that story is it's not done yet. That story of redemption continues into this present moment, into your life. And one day it will be brought to completion as Jesus returns in the fullness of His glory and of His power. And so we live as a people of great hope, looking to the author and the perfecter of our faith, Jesus Christ, who one day will return in robes of white. And so we're going to sing this last verse in grateful expectation as we look forward to His return.
He shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
We sing, oh, praise the name of the Lord our God.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forever.
Such a joy to declare that along with you. There is only one who we can sing those words about, our Lord, the Lord our God. I want you to hear these words from Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 1, verse 15. It says, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created, and he is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see, and he made the things that we can't see, such as thrones and kingdoms, rulers and authorities, even those in the unseen world that we cannot see. Everything was created through him and for him. Who else could we say this about other than Jesus? He existed before anything else, and he holds it all together. That's my hope today. And I encourage you to put your hope in the one who can hold it all together. Would you pray with me? Lord, we trust you to do just that. When we look at the world around us, Lord, we trust you to hold it all together. We trust you. We trust your hands who can hold it. No one else can do that. And so, Lord, we trust you with our world. We trust you with our lives. Lord, I ask, hold me together when I feel like I'm falling apart. I thank you that we can trust you to do that. Lord, we pray, Father, for the elected officials, those in authority who we can see, whose names we do know. Lord, we ask, God, that you would bless them, Lord, that you would convince them that you are God Almighty, that you are Lord our God. We pray, Lord, that you convict them where they are wrong and that you strengthen them to do what is right, Lord, and you give them vision, Lord. You give them an idea, an insight of what can be possible when you are acknowledged on your throne. We look to you. You are our Lord, and we put our trust in you, God. We think about Veterans Day coming up as well. And those who fought in this world, battles fought for freedom. And God, we acknowledge that you are the one who can free every man and every woman from whatever bondage holds them back. And we thank you for the freedom that we have to worship you and declare your name. We love you, God. And we thank you for your love for us. And so we pray together in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I am so glad to have this moment with you. And I want to welcome any of our first-time visitors. If you're a guest, if you have been invited to join us online, what a privilege to have you join us. Today, we're going to continue on in the message we've been in, Life with Jesus, as we look carefully at Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Mount and what they mean for us today. It's also a communion weekend, and so I encourage you to get some bread if you have some and a cup of juice, and be ready at the end of our time together. We're going to take communion. And want you to be ready to do that with us. Also want to encourage you to give online through our Christian Assembly app or on our website by clicking on the Give tab. You are such a generous people, and we thank you for your generosity. Now let's continue in our service and the teaching part of our time together.
Hey, welcome everybody to visitors or guests. My name is Tom. What a privilege to have you here with us. And of course, to my CA family, great to be with you as well. Well, this week we continue on in our series, Life with Jesus, looking at how Jesus calls us to live our lives in the light of this thing he calls the kingdom of God. And this week we're going to see that Jesus is going to speak to us about the human heart's tendency to worry. And in fact, as we all know, this was an election week, and that can create a lot of kind of worries or stress for people. And God's going to speak to us from his word, not just about elections, but about the human heart's tendency to worry. In fact, on the morning of September 25th, I was feeling worried. I was scheduled to have a surgery, and it was a hernia repair surgery, which I only tell you so that you are not worried that it was something worse. And in the lead up to the surgery, my doctor met with me, went through all the protocols of what he called risk awareness, basically telling me everything that could possibly go wrong with either the surgery or the general anesthesia. Well, after a very long laundry list of the horrible items that could go wrong, at the very end of that, he said to me, "But Tom, you have nothing to worry about." And I said jokingly to him, "What do you mean? You just literally gave me a list of 900 things to worry about and then made me sign a paper saying that I was aware of all those worrisome things. So I feel like you're sending me mixed messages here, Doc." And we just kind of laughed a little bit about it. Well, let me ask you, what are you worried about these days? Jesus spoke about worry, what it's often focused on, but also what its antidote is and how we can live a life without worry. We're going to consider that. But before we do, let's pray. So God, we thank you for this time. And Father, I ask that you would speak to us from your word. Your word is powerful. Your word is a source of life and strength and light and goodness for us. Lord, as we come and we hear your word to do not worry, might we allow your word to be more powerful than our fears, our worries, our anxieties? May we not just hear a message, but may we experience the power of you supplanting our worries with the strength of your calm word based off your love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, Jesus continues on in the Sermon on the Mount by saying these words in Matthew 6, verse 19 and onwards. "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body or what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about your clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown in into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'Well, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear?' For the pagans run after all of these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." Jesus' command here almost seems impossible. Do not worry about your life. How are we doing on that one, right? Our list of worries is long. We can be worried about elections, worried about our job, worried about our health, worried about our country, worried about being single, worried about being married. We can be worried about something a loved one is going through, a friend is going through. We can be worried about money. We can be worried about stuff. We can be worried about saving for future stuff. And the list goes on. Worry can not only damage your health, it can negatively affect the way that you treat others. It can disrupt your productivity, and it can rob you of the peace that God wants you to have today. So what is the key to not worrying about your life? I think the key to this whole passage is in Matthew 6, verse 22, where Jesus says this, "The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness?" Specifically, we need to understand what Jesus means by two words, the word lamp and the word healthy. A lamp determines both what you see, but also how you see it. If you go into a dark room with only a lamp on, we don't only see the lamp, we see everything else around it because of the lamp. So Jesus is saying here, when it comes to your worry, you experience your perspective. You experience your perspective. You're not just experiencing reality, you're experiencing your perspective of reality. So someone might say to me, "Well, Tom, look, if I could just earn enough, buy enough, save enough, then I won't be worried." But that's not really true. I've seen this in people's lives, and I know many of you have as well. I have sat with people who are poor, dirt poor amongst the global poor. They have nothing except a simple shelter, the clothes on their back, and their daily bread. And I left those encounters struck by their peace and their joy. Likewise, I've sat with people who have huge homes and tens of millions of dollars, more money than they could ever need. And yet I left some of those encounters struck by their worry and their fear. You know, we can have a life filled with stuff and a heart filled with worry. So what that means is how your internal world is ordered determines how you see your external world. And that's part of what Jesus is communicating here by using the lamp metaphor. Jesus is saying that worry is not only something that can come to us, it is also something that can come from us. We don't just receive worry based off the circumstances that are around us. Sometimes, and actually most times, we actually create it from our inside, our internal world, and then we project it out onto the lives around us, which then can become a vicious cycle of fear and more worry. So if you want to worry less, then Jesus is saying that you must ask God the Father to so saturate your heart and mind with His word and faith that you view everything you have and all of the circumstances that you encounter in your life, in the light of God's love and trust and care. That's why Jesus says, "And your heavenly Father knows you need all these things." The question that Jesus confronts us with when it comes to this topic of worry is this: will we have our eyes view all that I have and all the circumstances that I face that might make me feel worried through the light that I know that God loves me and He knows my needs? If so, then we will worry less and we will thank God more. And if not, then no amount of money will ever be enough to satisfy our fears or worries. When Jesus says, "If your eyes are healthy," it's important that we understand that word "healthy" that He's using there. The word actually means in the Greek, "if your eye is unbraided." So what he's saying is if your eye is unbraided, your whole body will be full of light. Now, we all know what a braid is, right? When several strands are woven together, combining different strands together. An unbraided eye, then, is an eye with a singular strand, an untwisted eye. It has a singular focus. Let me show you how this worked in my own life recently. Now, I wasn't worried about money or possessions. And let me even throw in there, you know, because I know it's an election week. You know, I wasn't even on this day really worried about an election outcome per se. But I was worried, and I was, I think this is going to help us understand how to bring our worries to God for God's perspective. Now, what had happened was my surgeon had told me that I had nothing to worry about, but then he gave me like 900 things that could go wrong with my surgery. So the morning of my surgery comes, it's September 25th, and I had spent time with the Lord that morning, as I do every morning, but on that particular morning, I realized that the lamp of my eye had been braided, that I could only see my surgery day through my worries of the bad that could happen, not through the hope that maybe God could actually use this day for his glory. So the morning of my surgery, it was early in the morning, I said, okay, God, I have given you all my concerns. You know them all. That was my way of remembering Jesus' words. Your heavenly Father knows your needs. But then I just prayed this prayer. God, would you help me change my perspective? Give me eyes to see this day as you see it. I want the lamp of my eyes to be unbraided, to be focused on what you're going to do today, to seek first your kingdom and not just to constantly rehearse to you my worries. And immediately I had this thought. The thought flashed through in my mind that today you will meet people, Tom, that otherwise you would never have met. And so I just prayed this little prayer. Lord, all of the time leading up to this day of this surgery, I have been praying, here I am, heal me. But now I want to add this second prayer. Here I am, send me. To whoever you want to send me to, whoever who I'll meet today. Now, I want to be honest with you. About 2/3 of my prayer was still heal me, and only about 1/3 of my prayer was send me, but God can use my little mustard seed of faith. God unbraided my eye in that moment. My gut feeling of worry began to lift. And I got into the car with my wife, who was driving me down to the hospital for the surgery, and I began to look for what it would look like to seek God's kingdom and his righteousness from a hospital bed. And it turned the day from a day of worry into wondering what God might have in store. So I go through the surgery, and I'm now in the recovery area as a nurse is now talking to me very loudly to awaken me from the general anesthesia. And she's asking me about my pain threshold, basically trying to wake me up and kind of make me alert as I'm coming through that. This is my discharge nurse. She's with me. Her name's Riley. Probably, I would guess, about 29 years old. I didn't actually meet her prior to the surgery, but she keeps talking to me loudly, asking me about pain thresholds and such things. She ends up sitting down next to me, next to the bed, talking to me. And I think of the fact that this is someone who I never would have met. So I'm kind of groggy, and I say something like this to her. I say, how are you holding up in the midst of the pandemic and everything else that's going on these days? And I remember her laughing, and she looked at me and said, how am I holding up? I'm supposed to be asking you how you're doing with your pain levels. But since you asked, I'll be honest, it's been tough. And honestly, I feel a little bit adrift, she said. I don't know, maybe even a little bit lost. Then she said, I thought about trying to go to church, but I've never actually been to one. I didn't grow up in church, but I do have a few friends who go to church, and they even talk about their church and how much their church means to them, but they've never actually invited me to go with them to church. Now, at this point, she doesn't know I'm a pastor. She doesn't even know I'm a Christian at this point. But I want to make a little side note here. Don't just talk about your church. Invite people to come with you, whether online or if you decide to join us at some point, the outdoor services we're doing at Village Christian. And I also want to say, way to go to all of you who are consistently doing that. Don't grow weary of inviting and including. Well, Riley continues, and then she says this. But then last week, I went to an outdoor church service that a different friend had invited me to. And I say to her, well, how was it? And she said, well, when the people sang, I felt something, but I don't really know what to do with that. And then I have a different coworker here at the hospital who talks to me about Jesus some, but I really don't understand it all. So now, okay, at this point, I'm still very groggy. I've got pain going on. I'm coming out of general anesthesia. I'm still feeling a bit disoriented. And my throat is still raspy from the breathing tube that was in my throat. But I say to her, Riley, what if God sent you someone today who could help you understand who Jesus is? And why he can change everything in your life to help you from feeling lost and adrift to feeling found and secure. Would you want that? And she looked at me. She had a mask on. Tears began to fill the brim of her eyes. And she said, I would want that. And all I can tell you is this, is when she said that, it is like the Holy Spirit gave me smelling salts. All of the pain, all of the confusion from the surgery I'd been through kind of lifted for the ensuing conversation. And I sense God's deep heart of love and compassion for this lost one. God is so good. So I explained to her the gospel of Jesus Christ as best I am able. And she said something like this to me. I'm not making this up. She maybe even sensed kind of God's spirit at work in me. She said to me in the middle of the conversation, how are you able to focus right now? You should still be fairly groggy and in a lot of pain and a bit disoriented. And I remember saying something like this, Riley, it might sound crazy to you, but the God that I know can lift my disorientation and pain because he wants me to be crystal clear to help you know how to come to know him. After I explained the gospel, I said, Riley, you can be saved right here, right now, if you're ready to place your faith in Jesus Christ. We can pray right now if you'd like to do so. With you just standing right there next to me in your hospital bed and me laying right here, do you want to give your life to Jesus? And at this point, she has tears streaming down her cheeks, and she says, yes, that's what I want. So on the third floor of Kaiser Permanente's surgery center in Hollywood, Riley takes my hand and I lead her and pray with her as she gives her life to the Lord for the very first time ever. She later gave me her email address and I followed up with her since. In fact, she just moved to New Orleans. And so Riley, if you're watching, I'm so proud of you. Welcome to the family of God. I'm helping her find a church there as well. I've gotten her a New Believers Bible, and we're so excited about how God is using your story, Riley. Now, here's the point. I was worried that day about my surgery, but God helped me to see that day through the lamp of his kingdom with an unbraided eye, that he knew all of my needs and concerns. For some of you, it might not be a surgery that you're facing. You might be worried about election outcomes. You might be worried about jobs. You might be worried about a friend who has something going on or a loved one. Jesus makes it clear that often our worry is focused on money and possessions. But when the lamp of our eye is healthy, when we view all that we have and all the circumstances that we face, especially the ones that we're tempted to be worried about, when we view all of those through the lens and lamp of the kingdom with an unbraided eye, that's when we begin to experience God's work in our life. Remember, whenever you come to your experiences, you don't just experience reality, you experience your perspective, your perception of reality. You might not be able to change all of your circumstances, but you can immediately, right now, change how you choose to view them. God's word and his spirit right now can change your interior world from one of fear to faith, from one of worry to worship, from one of not enough to God knows all that I need. Jesus is clear. When it comes to our basic needs, your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Because of this, I can make and you can make the kingdom of God my first thought, my first focus, the lens of an unbraided eye. And yes, as Jesus taught us last week, we can pray for our daily bread, but we don't have to worry about our daily bread. So we bring our concerns to God in prayer. We pray, but then we don't worry about them. If your eye is not clear on this matter, then it has the power to degrade your entire life. You will not only be worried all the time because you'll be so focused on all of the circumstances that make you afraid and worried, you'll miss the other good things that God wants you to be part of. God helped me set aside my worries about the surgery long enough to wonder if maybe he wanted me to focus on those around me instead of my own fears. Jesus says it this way, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. We often think of it like this when it comes to the topic of money and giving and generosity. We can think, well, if I get inspired, if my heart gets moved, then I'll give. But that's not how Jesus says that life in the kingdom works. When you live as a kingdom-ready disciple, it's give, and then your heart will follow. Elsewhere, God's word says it this way in 1 Timothy 6, verse 17 and on. It says this, teach those who are rich in this world not to be proud and not to trust in their money, which is so unreliable. Their trust should be in God, who richly gives us all we need for our enjoyment. Tell them to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works and generous to those in need, always being ready to share with others. By doing this, they will be storing up their treasure as a good foundation for the future so that they may experience true life. I love this because it shows that God is generous and gives us all we need for our enjoyment. He knows our needs. But he doesn't only give us it for that purpose. He also gives us enough that we can share with others because he goes on and he tells us to be generous to those in need, always ready to share with others. So when we're generous to those in need, we are storing up treasures in heaven. I think of it like investing, like I'm putting this money into something that I value, but that I also want to see God grow and expand God's kingdom. Jesus says it this way in Matthew 6, 24, as we already read, no one can serve two masters. Either you will hate one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Human life is not self-sufficient. It inescapably serves something that gives it meaning. The choice is not whether we will serve. The choice is only what and whom we shall serve with our life. And idolizing money and possessions can happen to both times when we are rich or poor. Rich people can idolize what they have, and poor people can idolize what they do not have. You know, every time I give back to God, it's a chance to unbraid my eye. It's a chance to remind myself of who my one true master is. It's a chance to choose faith over fear, worship over worry. I don't just give to a need. I have a need to give, and so do you. And when I give money away to those in need, I am saying to money, you are not my God. You are not my master. You are my servant. To do and express my faith and my loving Heavenly Father who knows all my needs. At one point here, Jesus says, "Oh, you of little faith." When he says that, little faith, what it means is that they have it, but it needs reassurance. It needs to grow. Jesus is not calling us to become birds or lilies, but to see God's loving care in all of creation and then to apply how we see God at work in our own lives as well. In other words, to address each day's problems and worries as they come, confident that your life is in the hands of the loving Father who knows your needs, who holds the whole world in his hands and will bring it to a worthy conclusion. You know, worry will never fix your tomorrow, but it can always poison your today. You can never worry yourself into a deeper relationship with God. But like me, on that day of my surgery when I felt so worried, like Riley on that day of the surgery when she attended to me and gave me great care, you can surrender yourself into a deeper relationship with God. You can choose to see all of life, including your possessions and money, with an unbraided eye, with a healthy eye, that sees it through the light of God's constant goodness and love and care for you both today and tomorrow and always. Before we come to the communion table, will you pray with me? God, help us to not worry. Help us to so allow our inner world to be ordered by you that we project a calm faith into our circumstances because of your great love. Let me ask you, are you worried about something today? It might be about money, but it could be something else, like it was that day for me about my health. Bring it to God right now. Trust in his care for you. He knows what you need. And then commit to seek first his kingdom and righteousness and trusting him to care for all of the other concerns we have. And let me remind us, when it comes to money and possessions, you cannot serve two masters. Either your money and possessions will serve God, or you will try to turn them into your God. But money can't save you. Ask God right now to break into the worrisome grip that money may have on your life. Ask him to help you grow in generosity, to invest more into his kingdom. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And lastly, the greatest thing you have to give God is your life. Like my friend Riley, if you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you can do so before we come to this table. Jesus Christ saw that we were in desperate need. Our sin had separated us from God, and he alone could repair the damage by coming and teaching us to know who God is and paying for our sin on the cross. And then he died on the cross to pay for our sin so that our record of sin could be canceled in front of a holy God, but also that we could do new life with him. And Jesus was raised to new life on that third day. You can give your life to Christ right now and say, God, I'm giving you my life. I'm asking you to make me one of your followers, one of your children. Help me to do my life in the light of your loving care shown through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus in your word. Give me your Holy Spirit and teach me to follow you all the days of my life. Hey, if you made a decision to follow Jesus Christ, let us know, and you are welcome at this table of communion. Likewise, maybe you've made the decision before to follow Jesus, you're welcome here as well. On the night that he was betrayed, he took a loaf of bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you do this in remembrance of me." And we're remembering that he died on the cross so that we could be made right with God. And so if you have your bread right now, God, would you take this simple bread and turn it into a means of us to remember what you've done in Jesus' name. Likewise, after the supper, he took a cup of wine and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant of me shedding my blood As often as you drink of this, do so in remembrance of me. So if you have your cup, you can go ahead and receive communion with me. And so God, now, even as I stand before this table, would you so help us to commune with you that when worry comes our way, that we would remember that you've provided for us in our salvation. How much more will you provide for all of our daily needs as well? And because of your great love, God, we can trust you for our salvation and all of our other needs as well. And because of that, we don't have to worry, and we can have peace this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
Louder. Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder.
Thank you so much for joining us online today. If you made a decision to follow Christ at any point during our service, or you'd like to know more about what it means to follow Jesus, we want to invite you to let us know so that a pastor can follow up with you. You can email us at the address, or you can text decision to the number 52855. Don't forget to follow us and stay in the know with our CA socials and on our Christian Assembly app. And now let me close with this benediction. I pray that you would find God filling your life and your home with His presence, and where He is present, that you might find Him at work in all of His power, and that you would be filled with the riches of His grace and the power of His Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll see you next week.